majesty, all things made by his decree. Hear creation's melody. Morning to everybody. I hope you are either close to one of our heaters or that you are nice and wrapped up so you can be warm this morning. Welcome to everybody that's joining us online. May you be blessed today just as we come into the presence of God. So Father, we just want to thank you that we can be here together and that your Holy Spirit is with us and that you in heaven are a community, and it is just so, so good that we can be the community on earth, reflecting that closeness and that unity. Won't you stand up? Won't you find somebody, give them a hug or a high five? Let's all just be a community together this morning. As we start this morning, I think we all need to just move around a bit, huh? Okay, so, yeah, can you all move around a bit? Okay, maybe raise your hands. All right, can you move around? All right, let's just really enjoy the presence of God. But let's clap and let's move around and let's just give our lives and our whole beings as a living sacrifice to the King of Kings this morning. One, two. 3, 4.
Every praise
sorry, but we need to move, and I'm stuck in a chair. All right,
I'm
and
stuck
you're
on
not.
A mic.
All right, and Jen is stuck behind a mic, but she can move. But
I
really
said,
just want to ask, can everybody jump? Anybody jump here?
Or just pretend if it's not going to work.
Can you
body
jump?
Wise.
No, that's not jumping. Feet off the ground, Jill. Yay! Okay. All right. I just feel that we've got to release something in the spirit here this morning. All right? And this is just such an amazing song because we're calling from deep, crying out to deep. And I just sense there are just so many actions and movements here that we can release the spirit in our midst this morning just by doing actions. So come on. I really just want to encourage you. I know it might feel awkward. That's okay.
Stirring up as we're serving up.
as the deer pants.
As the deer pants over the water, so my soul longs after you. Run along all my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield.
Instruments, let's just sing and lift our voices. We're going to take our in-ears out as well, so we can just hear everybody with us this morning. As the deer,
oh, as the deer pants for the water,
yes, Lord, we do.
Oh,
so longs after you, Lord.
After you. You desire, and I long to worship you. Oh, you alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield, and you desire, and I long
just you, Lord,
to worship you,
because you alone,
you alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield, because you
change the atmosphere. Let the weight of your glory hover here. Come and change the atmosphere.
With a heart of worship, I'm bringing in a brand new song. I'm ready to see the unthinkable. I'm ready for a miracle. Hearts praying for a fresh encounter. Souls looking to the living God. I'm ready for a real revival. We know you have so much more. We're looking to a new horizon. We're praying for your rain to pour. An overflowing of true redemption. An overflowing of your kingdom. We're ready for a real revival. Oh, Holy Spirit, come like a fire, like a fire.
Fill up.
let's just trust God for healings right now, right in this place. Lord, thank you for the healings that are falling. Thank you, Lord, for the fresh callings that you are releasing right now. Oh Lord, thank you for the miracles, Father God, that you are releasing now. Oh Lord, we just receive, we just position ourselves this morning to receive, Lord. Yes, Lord, oh, can you feel it? Heaven is reaching. Oh, can you hear it? Our God is speaking. Oh, can you see it? He's got your heart. Thank you, Lord. Oh, just receive it. Receive the freedom. Done a good job, eh? Because when we enter God's presence, we must never end full. You've got to always end wanting more and more and more. So we just love you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, that you leave us with a deeper hunger. We thank you that you leave us with a deeper thirst, Father God, that we would seek you not only now, but wherever we are. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, Enrique is going to join us. All right, will you join us?
Happy birthday to you.
I love that. Oh, is this one on already? Okay, let me just speak from here then. Cool, guys. Thank you. Thank you so much for the song. I was kind of, Daniel hinted at it at youth. He was like, oh, is it your birthday and you're preaching? Oh, then I'm going to ask the worship team to sing for you. And I was like, okay, let's see what happens. But thank you so much for that. Thank you for you guys for joining in as well. So yes, a very big welcome to all of you. You guys get to hear and hear my birthday message today that I get to share with you guys. I'm very excited for it. It's something that's meant a lot to me. But let's just first do the welcomes to everyone new here that might be here. I see a few new faces. If you came in today and it's your first time here, you haven't been here before, or maybe you're tuning in online for the very first time, we are so happy to have you here as well. If you are here in the service and you are new, as you go out on your left is the info desk over there. We'd love to give you a voucher there to enjoy some of the greatest coffee known to man. I want to quickly hype up this coffee and specifically one of our baristas as well. So, everyone here knows Sanson? You guys know Sanson, eh? Yes. So, the thing about Sanson is when all of these established coffee shops in Cape Town, okay, all the bootleggers, the Vidas, the Seattles, all those lacquer ones, need given training for their baristas. Do you know who they call? They call Sanson. He is not just a barista, but a trainer of the baristas, okay? Now, let's hear this. If Cape Town, South Africa, if the Western Cape has the biggest coffee culture, which it does, in South Africa, and I would say then the best baristas, and if Sanson is the trainer of those baristas, that makes Sanson the best barista in South Africa, okay? And so, if you are, as you're going after the service, please don't rush out. We'd love to join you for a cup of coffee. Go over there to Streams. You'll be greeted very so amazingly by Sanson and by Lloyd, and they'd love to make you a cup of coffee. Bless you in your day. If you're a visitor and you want to sit down with someone and find out more about about this church after the service, someone at the info desk will assist you as well. But now we are going to tune in to the notices. So have a look at the screens.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to have you in the ESCC Hall with us this morning. We've got some information for you about two events coming up at El Shaddai. Bruce is starting the God Movement Focus Group next week, Sunday after the service. This is a six-week workshop running here in the hall directly after the service. It will teach you more about God's calling on your life and your unique contribution in God movements. Everyone is welcome, regardless of your age, spiritual walk, or where you worship. We recommend that you have already done the introduction to God movements. If, however, that is not the case, please contact us anyway and let us know you are interested in joining this module. You will find all the information and contact details on our website. Tubi is running a financial foundation seminar in September. It will help you to understand money, finances, and wealth in the light of God's Word. It is an excellent seminar and will provide you with the answers to questions that many people face today regarding finances. The registration and cost details for this seminar also on the ESCC website. And lastly, we honor those who faithfully give of their tithes and offerings every month. Most people do this via EFT nowadays, which is our preferred choice. If you don't have our banking details, you will find them on our website. Look for the Give push button on the homepage or the Give tab at the top of the page. However, if you prefer to give cash, there will be a box on the stage after the service that you can make use of. Have a wonderful week, everyone.
All righty. Thank you for coming this morning and having a listening into our Filling Your Tank series. This is the third week of our series, and it is all about this. Right, in this post-2020, okay, this post-2021 and this now 2022 season, and what we are calling the post-COVID season as well, a lot of us are mukh, okay?
I certainly am feeling very much after this whole 2020 saga, and I'll be sharing a bit of that now and just how, what can speak into it. But we are standing here in this place, and a lot of us need to rebuild in this season. A lot of us need to rebuild into our businesses, into our families, and into our own personal lives as well. But we believe that's where it starts. The best way that you can make a difference in society is by first feeding and filling yourself. And that is what this Filling Your Tank series is about. It's about stepping out of this bubble of fear that we might have had. Oh, wow, what's going to be going on? Am I going to be as good as I could have been? Is God going to be with me in this? Oh, but all of these hectic things have happened. No, we're going to be stepping out of that bubble of fear, and we are going to be stepping out with Jesus. And particularly this sermon today, I've titled it, Great is Thy Faithfulness. The reason why is because I believe that Jesus has given you, he's given me, he's given us a given direction, okay? He has spoken things before COVID, he spoke things during COVID, and he's speaking things after it now as well. Won't you so trust him and not so look towards what you can see, not so look towards what you can do, but look towards him and his faithfulness? That is what I really want you to get out of this message. It comes from a very deep place in my personal life, and I'll be explaining that as we're going into this. We'll then look at scripture in Luke 8, where Jesus is in the boat with his disciples, and there's a storm going about. We'll start to see what Jesus actually did in the storm, and what he expects of us to do as well when we are facing given storms. We'll draw 3 points out of that, which I believe that he wants to speak to us here as a congregation. And then there are 3 challenges that I believe he wants to challenge us with in this next season, so that we truly can have his posture during the storm and not the posture of ourselves. Right, we're excited for that. That's where we're going. That's the overarching thing. Right, let's go. Let's get into it. So, yellow, sure. This and a huge part of this message actually comes out of my experiences of youth from 2020 onwards. So let me tell you about where we were at as a youth, where we are at, and then where we intend to go. So we found ourselves, sorry, I saw Philip laughing at me. Yes, thank you, Philip. We find ourselves here in 2020. Myself and Michael are sitting down, and we're like, wow, okay, we are absolute veterans at this now. Okay, we've been running youth ministry for 4 years. We know exactly all the ins and outs of it. We've learned every single lesson there is to learn in youth ministry, and now we're coming into our glory year. Oh, wow, but we've walked with little lighties from when they were young in children's church and where they're at now, and now the Phillips and the Renens, they're even taller than us, and like, wow, okay, like we're in this now. We know everything about youth ministry, and we're going to go for it. And then the coronavirus. Ah, sure. Then 2020 came with all of its COVID stuffies, and myself and Mike sat and were like, wow, okay. So well and truly, new curveballs can be thrown at us. And maybe you were like so as well at the beginning of 2020. You were like, wow, okay, I've prepped and I've planned everything in my 2019, and now I'm going into 2020, and now things are going, okay? Remember that whole thing, 2020 vision, okay? Like we're going, we're looking at it, we're going to see through it, and we're going to go for it. And then lockdown, things were shut down. But I can tell you that in our youth, things did not shut down. In fact, they got ramped up to a great degree, because I saw these youth leaders do the most amazing of things. Number one, they all pulled together their little groups that they had, and they literally carried the youth, okay? Myself and Michael gave as much input as we could, but we wouldn't have a youth today if they didn't step up to the plate, take responsibility for what was in their circle, and lead in the most amazing of ways. And I honor them amazingly so for that. They also participated very much so in the community and really helped champion amazing causes and were involved. They were there reaching out to people working and living on the street. They were there packing food parcels. They were doing the thing and making the world a better place. A lot of them were going into people's houses who didn't know how to work, technology. They were delivering groceries for people and all those kinds of things. And I can truly say that I'm so privileged to have the youth that I do. But now then we came back, okay? We could come back in our normal-sized gatherings mid-2021. And I saw something very different in front of me. So imagine this, okay? So you're in a given congregation, you're here at Al Shaddai, and you walk in the one Sunday, and you know everyone. You're like, hi, there's this auntie, there's this uncle, here's my friend. You go back, and you come back the following Sunday, and 80 to 90% of the people are new people. It's just you and that remaining 15, 10%, and you're like, ooh, these other people that are here, and where did they come from? Okay. So that was the situation we were presented with in 2021, coming in now to 2022. 80% of those young people, I didn't know who they were. I was like, okay, so you come from Al Shaddai, okay, you homeschooled, you don't really go to school, what's going on here? The amazing diversity as well that we found is just unparalleled and unmatched. I mean, we have people from all different types of schools, we have people from all different types of ethnicities, we have people from all different types of cultures, groups, and religious beliefs even. A lot of the people, they aren't Christian. I was really surprised and actually thankful for that. Like, wow, you guys are deciding to come to this on your Friday service? Okay, that's good. Thank you for being here. A lot of the congregation as well were of the kids that I had journeyed with from the Morningstar Community Center as well. So then you had all of this great diversity. And I can tell you it was an amazing, sure, opportunity. I see it as, but quite a challenge as well. But there was one particular time, I remember I was standing with Sean at the back over there, and we were looking at the groups, and everyone was in their little groups, and they were sharing with each other. And Sean said this thing to me that I will never forget. He said, Enrique, these are the things, this is the moment our parents have been fighting for all of these years. This is what should have happened 20 years ago. And obviously he's referring to the ills of the past that have now been put back together. But I saw amazing community and unity in that particular service. And I see it so now here as well in our youth services. But it was difficult and it still is. I'm telling you, with all this amazing diversity and these people not really knowing each other and skiffing each other, and then there's young people as well, so just in general they know each other and skiff each other all of the time. It's amazing to see what God is doing in the youth right now. And Jesse gave this word when I was meeting with him. So those of you that have done races of sorts, okay, maybe some of you are going to do the gun run that's coming up now. Depending on your qualifying time, you start at different sections in the race, okay? So the people with the fastest qualifying time, they'll go up first, and they'll go around, and then the next, and the next. And JC was sensing that we were somewhat at the back. But with every single stride that we had made forward, we'd come a bit closer, and a bit closer, and a bit closer. And finally now, last week Friday, was our time that we were going to start and run into the new things of God. And that is the place where we find ourselves in now. Maybe you are sitting here this morning and there was a word spoken over you. Maybe you're sitting here this morning and there's something that God promised you before COVID that you thought broke down and you now sit with in this quote-unquote post-COVID season with. I want to challenge you today. And I want to challenge you for the rest of your time after this message to look towards His given direction and to look towards Him. Because I can tell you that I, in those times when youth was so chaotic and still sometimes is very chaotic, I can't look towards what I can see, okay? Because I just see kids running around, I just see this, I just see that. I can't look at that. I can't look towards my own ability. I can't look to me and say, wow, okay, I can get everyone under control. I can make sure that everyone has the greatest relationship with God. I can't do that. But what I do look towards is Jesus and the promises that he has made to me. And I challenge you to look to the same things today. So let's look at the scripture. Luke 8, verse 22 to 25. One day Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side of the lake." So they got into a boat and set out. As they sailed, he fell asleep. A squall came over down on the lake, so the boat was being swamped, and they were in great danger. The disciples went and woke him, saying, "Master, Master, we're going to drown." He got up and rebuked the wind and the raging waters. The storm subsided, and all was calm. He asked them this, "Where is your faith?" He asked his disciples. In fear and amazement, they asked one another, "Who is this? He commands even the winds and the water," and they obey him. Look at this part that it starts with. It starts with this. One day Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side of the lake." So they got into a boat and set out. He, right there in the beginning, before they even went anywhere, established the direction. He said, "We are getting in this boat, guys, and we are going there. And no matter what comes or goes, we're getting in this boat and we're going to set destination. Whether a storm or rain comes, okay, whether we are going to be challenged or not, we are getting in this boat and we are going." And I know God has said that to you as well. And he says these things in his word as well today. He spoke this over his disciples. But they got a bit restless in the boat. They saw the storms. They saw their own ability maybe to adjust the things. And they were like, "Okay, no, this boat is going to fall over." But he gets up out of his place of rest. He speaks to the storm. He doesn't allow it to speak to him. And he asks them, "Oh, but where was your faith?" And I believe that there are three things today that he deeply wants us as well to get out of this. And these three things are as such. Number one, it comes from this scripture over here. As they sailed, he fell asleep. This given storm came down. The boat was being swamped. They were in great danger. Okay? Look at this. While the storm was going on, Jesus was resting. And this is my first point. Jesus is resting in the storm. Are you? You might be going through a given storm at work, a given storm in your family, but Jesus is resting in that storm. And I want to ask you today, are you resting in that storm? This word, Sabbath, you guys may all know of it. You might think it means rest. It doesn't mean rest. It actually means to stop, to cease from doing. To stop, to cease from doing. I thought, okay, cool. I can go on, I can go on, I can go on through this crazy youth season. But no, no, no. I too had to take my Saturdays, go and have some coffee, go for a walk throughout Durbanville, and just chill. And I want to ask you now as well, in the given storm that you have been facing, are facing, and are yet going to face, are you going to stop and cease from doing? Are you taking that moment in the week, even though things are hectic, incredibly hectic, to stop and maybe build a relationship with your spouse? Are you taking that moment to stop, despite all of the other nonsense going on, and go for a walk? Are you taking that moment to stop, despite everything else going on, and putting aside some time just for praying and just for fasting maybe? Because that's what Jesus was doing in the storm. Even though everything else was going on, even though the winds and the waves were coming, Jesus was in a state of rest. And I believe that he wants everyone here to join him in that state as well. So that is the first point that I deeply want you to get out of this. If there is a given storm, don't be running around. Don't be trying to trust in your own ability to maybe calm the winds and the waves. Simply stop, because that is what he so requires of you today. So try to stop in the storm. That is the first thing. The second thing is this. It comes from this verse. He got up and rebuked the wind and the raging waters. The storm subsided, and all was calm. This is the second point. He spoke to the storm instead of allowing the storm to speak to him. Okay? How many of us here are sitting today in facing a given storm that we are in, and we are just being quiet and allowing the negativity to just wash over us? We're just taking another punch. Okay, we're just allowing that voice to speak to us. We're allowing that voice, not just necessarily from others, but that voice of ourselves that is negative and it's speaking to us. Oh, but you'll never make it. Oh, but you tried it last time. Did it work last time? It didn't work last time. So why would it work again? Oh, but the economy is in the absolute worst place. Oh, but our country is in the worst place. However will we get investment into this? However can I start a small business now? However can I put my family together despite all of this nonsense going on around me? The biggest negative voice is often, I've certainly found this in my life, and I think it's like this. Sometimes we give the devil a little too much credit, because really so, when I'm going through big storms, there's a negative voice from the devil. Oh, yes, it's there. There's negative voices from others. They always are. But often, the biggest negative voice comes from yourself. And if we had to first stop, the second thing that we have to do is to speak to the storm and not allow it to speak to us. We have to make sure that we are filling our hearts with positivity. We are filling our hearts with the best of things and speaking back at whatever is speaking out at us. That is the posture we have to take. Jesus got up from his restful state. He didn't fear in the storm like many of us do. He spoke to the storm instead of allowing it to speak to him. And that's what we have to do after we get up in the storm and we are faced with all of these pressures. The third point is as such. He asks us, where is your faith? This is what he asked the disciples. Where is your faith? Now I can tell you that many a times, I place it in my own ability. Sometimes for given meetings that I'm about to step up into, I think, wow, I've got a very good way with words. I've got a very good way with winging things. And then maybe I would underprepare. Okay? Do you know why? I put my faith in my own ability right there. I didn't put it in God's ability to lead me. If something maybe looks good on a given day, okay, for me, maybe I'm in my given house, at the second phase house, and things seem fine, okay, things seem to be going okay. Maybe I won't put in too much prep in the house meeting, for example, that I'm about to do, because things seem fine. But I've learned a very incredible lesson over the past while, is that structure is incredibly important. And the church staff here will smile and wink at me because they think I might be the least structured person, and perhaps I am, but it is a lesson that I am learning. And using something like a given structure tells me, okay, I'm not going to be putting that faith in myself in order to wing a given thing. I'm rather going to put my faith in something else, something that I believe God has put out for me. If God has said something for a given house meeting, I'm going to walk into that. If God has said something out for a given thing that he wants me to speak in, I'm going to walk into that instead of allowing myself to take control over those things. And then within this question as well, with Jesus now asking his disciples, where is your faith? I want to ask you that now today. Are you drawing from the Word of God? Are you drawing from your own time with him? Or are you drawing from someone or something else? I'm going to tell you very honestly here that for the most part, really so, when I'm struggling, prayer is often not my first resort. It's probably like the third or fourth resort. Okay? I either want to turn to, okay, things are panicky and whatever. Okay, let me just go and take a walk. Okay, let me just go and do that. Maybe if I just watched one more series, okay, I'd feel a bit more rested. No? Maybe if I just watched a motivational video on YouTube, I'd feel motivated to get up and going again. But I'm sure God can, and he does, use those things, because those are good things that I believe He's put out for us, but they cannot be our first resort. Faith in God and looking towards Him needs to be our first resort. It cannot be our third, fourth, or often last resort. And I'm speaking to myself now as much as I'm speaking to any one of you here this morning, because that is something I struggle with as well. But look here, even in the disciples' deep doubt, even while they were running around, and maybe you're running around here, okay? Maybe you're doing circles and laps in your head, trying to figure out what is the rest of this year going to look like. Gosh, it's August already. August of 2022. Like, not 2020, not 2021, it's 2022. Maybe you are sitting here and you're like, oh gosh, where's the rest of this month's finances going to come from? It's only the 7th of August, but we've already spent half the budget. Maybe you're sitting here this morning and, oh God, I really need you to come through for me with business. I'm not seeing it. There are no more clients coming through. But I want you to do this. Ask yourself deeply, so, where am I getting my sources and my resources from? And if you turn to God as a first resort, and I think that's like the one thing the disciples got right here in this passage, okay? They went to Jesus when times were getting tough, and He actually stood out for them. And He asks them this, oh, but where is your faith? And we need to look towards that as well. Right. I've mentioned these 3 points now. It were these. Jesus is resting in the storm. Are you? The second was this. He spoke to the storm instead of allowing the storm to speak to Him. And the third was this. The question He's putting to you today, where is your faith? And now here come 3 application points, 3 challenges from each part of the scripture that I believe we can take into our hands today. I'm telling you, this is tried and tested. Okay, when I was going through the deep and the hectic, most hectic of youth times, I had to do these 3 things. And I felt that it actually helped. So I want to share them with you as well. Number one, this is a very punchy one. Okay, check yourself before you wreck yourself. Okay, I want you to get this and you need to write this down. Check yourself before you wreck yourself. The reason why I'm saying this is because you might think, okay, I'm in a very, like, a good state. I'm in a very elevated state. But maybe you're just running on adrenaline. Okay, maybe something might be going wrong in you in terms of your spirituality. Something might be going wrong in terms of your family life or your work life. But maybe you're just not sure, like, what it is. This is the first point. Remember, Jesus is resting in the storm. Are you? Jesus stopped in the storm. That's what the word Shabbat means. Are we? Here's a very practical thing that you can do. Okay, so this thing is called the wheel of life. I think Bruce shared it at some point with our staff as well, maybe 2 years ago. So what you do is this. You draw a circle, okay? This is very practical. It's very easy to do, okay? You can do it at any given point. Maybe if you're feeling that you need to stop at work, maybe if you're feeling you need to stop just before you go and sleep, you can do it at any one of those times. This is what you do. Just draw a circle. Divide that circle into what you believe are the different sections of your life. So I have a few examples here, okay? Spirituality, health, family, social life, work, money, home, and maybe entertainment, okay? Those were 8, but you can even simplify it and make it a lot easier for yourself, okay? Then what you do, you color in, because now your thing looks like a pie, okay, or a pizza. I mentioned 8 things, a pizza, okay. Now it looks like a little pizza. And just color in, or kind of rank at a certain point, maybe out of 10, where that given spot is currently in your life, okay. So one thing I do is that I rank health and exercise, okay. I'll check myself. Okay, remember, you're checking yourself before you're wrecking yourself. Okay, so you're checking yourself. This week, what did I eat? How many times did I exercise? Did I drink enough water? Am I sleeping properly? Okay, in all of those things, I think I'm at about a 7. So I color in about a 7th of the block. Okay, cool, I'm there. 70% of the block, I color it in. And I do those for all of the other things. I then ask myself, and this is really quick, it takes a few minutes. I then ask myself, what is one thing I can do to move one level up in this next week? What is one thing I can do to move one level up in this next week? And maybe it might be as simple as, okay, in this next week, I haven't been walking at all. I haven't been exercising. I haven't been going to the gym. I usually do things, but I don't. But this week, to move one level up in terms of my health, my fitness, and my exercise, I'm going to go for a 20-minute walk. I'm going to give myself 7 days to do it. Okay, it's not going to happen on the first day because I'm going to be too lazy. It's not going to happen on the second day because I'm going to procrastinate it. But maybe on the Wednesday, I'm going to go and take this walk. And you do all of those things for all those different areas. Okay, maybe you can do it in terms of your family life. Okay, maybe you're being really honest with yourself. Wow, I didn't really get to spend enough time as I wanted to with my family this week. Okay, I was missing my wife, I was missing my husband, we were just going in work, we were living separate lives. I didn't really get to spend enough time with my kids. Oh, but they just came home from practice and they were a bit late at school and what. Okay, in this next week, to move from a 5 to a 6, we are gonna take the Saturday and we're just gonna go for ice cream. It's gonna be very cheap, I'm gonna pay like a few rands and we're just gonna go for ice cream. And you know what? At the end of that week, it won't be a 5, it will be a 6. Okay? It's to be found in the small incremental differences. That's where the meaning, that's where the movement forward in life is to come from. Okay? So do this exercise. It's very quick. It's very simple. You can even do it now. It's the one thing I will forgive you for if you're not listening. Okay? If you take a piece of paper right now, you draw a circle, you divide it into a few areas of your life. Okay? You rank where you are at. And you think of one thing you can do to make that area of your life better, then you don't have to listen for the rest of the sermon. Right, the second thing, speak it into existence. The point over there was, he spoke to the storm instead of allowing the storm to speak to him. Now, this concept of speech in the Bible, you find it right from the Old Testament to the New Testament about how powerful it is. How did God bring the world into existence? He spoke it into existence. He said, let there be light. Okay? He said it. He spoke it. He articulated it into existence. And the power of speech goes even more. We find it again in the Old Testament, okay? When they were walking around the walls of Jericho, what did they have to do? They had to shout. And the walls came down. Okay? I don't know if you know that song from Children's Church. Around the walls of Jericho, around the walls. Okay? I was taught growing up that that is a song I can even sing when I'm in deep times of trouble and doubt. And you find this again here in this challenge that I believe God's put up to us. He spoke to the storm. What you can do is you can speak positivity into being. That promise that you've so had on your heart, I want you to go out of your way to include it in a conversation this week. It can be absolutely so ridiculous. Okay, but go out of your way to speak it. Here's something I'm going to do. I'm going to do it right now in front of you. So, at the end of this year, going into next year, I want to buy a house. It's going to happen. Okay, and you know what I'm going to use this for? Okay, the guys in my second phase program now are exiting, and they need to move on to their next stage of accommodation. Something that's slightly more independent, that allows more agency. And I have this concept that I want to start, the somewhat of this third phase house, okay? I was thinking about it, but after speaking to a business strategist about it, I should actually start it as a business, okay? And I'm going to call this business Ezluwini. Do you know what that means? It means heaven. That is what it means, because that's what I want this house to be able to be for people that have gone through the worst in life and that are coming up now. So just like I've done now, I've spoken it out. There was an opportunity to share it, and I took it, and I am going to share it. I want you guys to do that as well. If it was a promise spoken over your life, over your family, if it is something that you are hoping for, that you are wishing for in your business, speak it out in this given week. Indeed, it is how the walls of Jericho fell down. Indeed, it is how the very world came into existence, and it is how the storm subsided when Jesus spoke to it. And so what you've got to do this week as well, you've got to speak it into existence. That's point number two. Application point number three is this. Write the future. The point is simple. Write the future. You've got to make this thing visible. Remember, the main point of this message is this, is that Jesus has given you a given direction. He gave the disciples a given direction. Are you trusting in your own ability to see, in your own ability to do, or are you trusting in Him and in what He said? So what you've got to do, you've got to write that thing out. You've got to stick it on your wall. You've got to put it there on the dashboard of your car. You've got to put it as the wallpaper, like on your phone, okay, so that you are constantly reminded of this. You've got to put it on your desk at work, whether it's something you feel that you've got to remember, something that you've got to remind yourself of, something as simple as you want to say every single day to somebody, whether it's a good word, whether it's anything like that. You've got to write it out, and you've got to make it visible. You've got to write the future in this kind of way. This has meant a lot to me, because what I started to do because of this, and Meshach will know, Meshach stays with me, he stays in my room with me. I have given things that I've written on my wall. I have changed recently the wallpaper of my phone to something that I want to strive towards and live out in my life. These are the things I've done. I've made it visible for myself. So these are the things you've got to do as well, okay? Number one, you've got to check yourself before you wreck yourself, okay? Make that wheel of life. Ask yourself, how can you become one point better in any one of those given areas this week? Second thing, you've got to speak it into existence. You've got to call it by its name, and you've got to speak it out just as God did in Genesis, just as God's people did in Jericho, and just as Jesus did in this New Testament to the storm. You've got to speak it out. And number three, write the future. Write it out. He asked the disciples, where are they putting their faith? Where are you putting your faith? Write that out. Make it visible so that you can see it. Remember I told you this came out of a deep space of the things I was struggling with at youth? So now on Friday, we opened up the space to worship, but worship in a different way. We worshiped in the form of testimonies and stories of gratitude. And my, oh my, for those that were there, it was an incredibly emotional time for me, from story to story. This one guy in particular, he got up and he said that he was struggling so much at school. He was being bullied. There was someone else that was being bullied that he was standing up for. And he reached out to a given family member of his. He felt that he couldn't reach out to his parents during that time. But one thing changed. That family member introduced him to our youth. And he said these three things that he's thankful for. He said, because of the worship, because of the leaders, and because of this youth as a whole, he says he now has a restored relationship with God. And despite all of the things I had been going through, all of the things we journeyed together with as a youth, I can say that for that boy and for the many others that shared that day, because they said they found a place of home and community in youth, despite all of the chaoticness, I was like, you know what, God? I'm not going to look at what I can see. I'm not going to look at my own ability. I'm going to look at you, and I'm going to look at your promises. And that is my challenge for you here today, to do exactly that. See if you can do these three things in this week, okay? See if you can create this wheel of life, speak to that thing, and see if you can write it out and write the future. Remember these three points, that Jesus is resting in the storm. Are you? Jesus spoke to the storm. Instead of allowing it to speak to him, are you going to speak to the storm? And the question that he poses to you today, where is your faith? I believe that if we answered that question with, my faith is in you, Jesus, we'll be able to come out of this post-COVID season with a full tank. we'll be able to have better family lives. We'll have fuller families. We'll be able to be more productive at work because we are fuller ourselves. If we can do these basic things in our given lives, I know we'll make our families better. I know we'll make our workspaces better. I know that this given community here in Durbanville will be a better place, and that will spill out to the rest of the world. Remember, God has given you a global mission, okay? He said, go forth, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'll be with you to the very end of the age. He gave you a global mission, but he gave you a garden to tend towards. He gave a similar challenge to Adam and Eve as well, but he gave them a garden to tend towards. So let's tend towards our own garden first. Let's fill our tanks and watch that spill over into the rest of the world. Lord God, I come to you in Jesus' name. I'd like to thank you for this amazing opportunity that I had today to share practical lessons from a deep space in my heart, that you, from a journey that you walked with me and walked with our youth. Lord God, I know that there are people sitting today in this congregation that are going through storms of their own. And well and truly, we will all go through storms of our own in the coming seasons. Lord God, help us to find your posture in the storm. Let us not rely on our own strength. Let us not rely on our own sight. But Jesus, as I am struggling, trying to keep the boat afloat, I see you resting in the corner of the boat. And I believe that that's an invitation to today. For me to join you. For me to join you in your posture in the storm. And so, Lord God, I tell you that I want to do that now this morning. And I pray that over every single congregant here today, that we might find your posture in the storm. We won't look to our own sight. We won't look to our own strength and our own ability. But we will lay all that down and look to you and what you've spoken over our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. With blood, wholeheartedly.
God, you're so good to me. Oh God, you're so
encouraged us to do as we just allow the Spirit to move and make us more and more hungry of the things of Him this week.
God, you're so good.